thankful that they kept a periodic session, especially on the subject which is one of the most common chronic periodic renal problem. So I think we are already running short of time, so I would like to introduce the speaker who is going to continue with nephrotic syndrome, but this would be another aspect of nephrotic syndrome, that is, which is not responsive to steroids. Generally, as we all know, that nephrotic syndrome in specific age group in children, that is generally, if there are no atypical features, that is steroid sensitive, but at times patients do not respond to steroids, or they would have features which would signify disease other than possibly minimal change disease. So Dr. Ali Asghar Lenwala, who is head of pediatric nephrology department at Sindh Institute of Urology and Transplantation, he has a wide experience and it's a privilege to have him here, and he is going to discuss the steroid, the difficult nephrotic syndrome.
Thank you very much for the introduction and the invitation by the PSN organizing committee. Actually, we've been doing this pediatric nephrology sessions in PSN meetings for the last three consecutive meetings. And it's been an honor and privilege for us to be here. So what I'll be dealing with, I don't have any conflict of interest. I'll be dealing with difficult to treat nephrotic syndromes. And basically, like Dr. Kimchuk mentioned, the steroid dependent and frequent relapses who have used the second line treatment with either levomizole or cyclophosphamide, and in cases of frequent relapses, if they fail to respond to levomizole, then they can get cyclophosphamide and still they continue to get relapses. So these are the steroid sensitive ones, but they require multiple and frequent doses of steroids which are very toxic to them in the long run. So these are those patients where you want to treat them with a third line or a fourth line medication so that you can avoid these high doses of steroids and long-term toxicity. Then there is a group of patients who do not respond to steroid to begin with. You know, from their first episode, you've given them a full dose of steroid for 2 weeks and they come back with persistent or increased edema and persistent proteinuria. You continue that for 2 more weeks, and at 4 weeks, if they have edema and proteinuria, they are primary steroid resistant. There is a small group of patients in this row that they do respond to steroid to an extent that their edema improves. However, they continue to have proteinuria. And in those patients, we have seen in our personal experience that if we continue those steroids for 2 more weeks, then they may then respond to steroids and become steroid sensitive. However, the cutoff is at 6 weeks, that at 6 weeks, if the proteinuria is persistent, then they are steroid resistant. But if the edema is persistent at 4 weeks, there is no need to continue that very high dose of steroid for further. And then there is a third entity which are called late non-responders. These are the ones who come back with a relapse. They were steroid sensitive in the past. You are treating for a relapse and after 2 weeks you find out that they are not responding, and even they don't respond after 4 weeks. And this can happen at any point in the course of their disease that they may not stop responding to steroids. Fortunately, this is a very small proportion of all these patients. So I'll deal with all these three entities. All these patients, before starting any other treatment, we recommend strongly that they should have a kidney biopsy done at that time before starting any other treatment. And if they are at places where kidney biopsies are not available, the facility is not available, we recommend that they should be referred to such facility. And now, thankfully, there are so many, in every part of our country, there are many places where kidney biopsies can be done. I'm not going to deal with those patients on whom the histopathological lesions would show a membranous nephropathy or a disease and your capillary glomerulonephritis, because they're two different topics, and they're very, they have been dealt with in this Congress in separate sessions alone, membranous and MPGN. But I would just concentrate on those who have their EGFRs preserved, and they have in their histopathological lesions, they may have NCD or any of its variant, FSGS or IgM nephropathy, IgA nephropathy, any other nephrotic syndrome lesion other than membranous and MPGN. So I'll give you some data about the use of methylprednisolone pulses. It was postulated that children who are steroid resistant are actually because their peripheral mononuclear cells have a very low density of glucocorticoid receptors. And that's why they justify that if they give we give a high dose of methylprednisolone to them, they will then respond. So this Mendoza protocol was published in 1990, and this protocol gives hefty doses of steroids. You can see that they give 30 milligram per kilogram IV methylpred every other day for 6 doses, then every week 8 doses, every 2 weeks, then every 4 weeks, and every 8 weeks, along with oral steroids. So these are, and then the same group published a 5-year benefit of this protocol, that they did not have any side effects. It is so difficult for us to believe that these trials have not been replicated anywhere else. Nobody else can be willing to give these high doses of steroids. So the French Society, they only recommend 3 IV pulses at the end of 4 weeks. If they have not responded to steroids and they have persistent edema, then at the end of 4 weeks, they recommend that you give only 3 pulses. But we believe that 2 milligram per kilogram is still a very high dose, and if they have not responded in 4 weeks, we do have very good alternate therapies. So we do not recommend, our consensus group, we do not recommend these pulses in methylprednisolone at all. Now coming to the mainstay of treatment, the calcineurin inhibitors, the cyclosporin and tacrolimus. How they work is, one is their immune suppressive effect. What they do is they block the T cell activation. They stop the communication between the T cells and B cells, so the B cells do not mature into the plasma cells. And the T cell activation and further chemotaxis and all that is also masked. And they have an intrinsic effect on the glomerular capillaries and the permeability, and the direct effect that vasoconstriction on those arterioles would also decrease the proteinuria. So this is from that a very nice review on the use of calcineurin inhibitors in nephrotic syndrome. There have been multiple randomized controlled trials to establish the efficacy and the beneficiary effects of calcineurin inhibitors in nephrotic children, both in adults and in children. And they've compared different medications. This French trial was compared to clarimucil and showed beneficial effect of cyclosporin. Italians compared it with cyclophosphamide, and again, cyclosporin was way better. Then this Japanese trial was done on randomizing to 2 groups. One group received a fixed low dose of 2.5 milligram per kilogram every day of cyclosporin, and the other group started with the 5 milligram per kilogram, and the doses were adjusted according to the response and over a period of time. So this second group did much better. In the literature, they have shown that the steroid-sensitive ones, the dependent and the frequent relapses, if you treat them with cyclosporin, the response rate is up to 75%. And for the steroid-resistant one, it's about up to 45%. We have not published this, but we have computed our response rates, and it speaks steroid sensitive ones, our response rate is more than 90%. And the steroid resistant ones, if you include both the partial and complete remission, the response rate is more than 70%. It was around 72%. We haven't published this data, but our own experience in our local population is the calcineurin inhibitors were much better as compared to the European population. So how do we go about with cyclosporine and aortic polymers? After we've done the biopsy, we start them with cyclosporine, 5 mg per kilogram in 2 equal divided doses and given every 12 hourly. And along with that cyclosporine, we give them 1 mg per kilogram every other day of steroids. The response is usually seen after 6 weeks. So we do our first follow-up after 6 weeks. We check their serum creatinine and serum albumin and urine dipstick. If at 6 weeks they have already responded, protein is negative, the serum albumin is more than 2.5, creatinine has not increased significantly, then we can start tapering the steroids at 6 weeks if you have seen the response. But if there is still no response, then you can continue the same dose of steroids and cyclosporine for 6 more weeks. So that would make it at 3 months. Next follow-up, on the second follow-up after 6 weeks, if you see that there is a response, then you can again start tapering the steroids, but to continue the same dose of cyclosporine. If there is no response at 3 months, then that is the time that you address the effect of cyclosporine, and that is when we check their TRAF levels. Our target TRAF level is from 120 to 150, maximum is 150. If they have achieved, have adequate TRAF levels of cyclosporine and have used it for 3 months and still have proteinuria, then that is the time that we call it that they have not responded to cyclosporine. And you can change the therapy. Now change to what? We initially at SIUT we use cyclosporine as first line, and then we have seen that in those children who do not respond to cyclosporine, if we switch them to tacrolimus, then the response rate may, almost half of these children may respond to tacrolimus if they had not responded to cyclosporine. Tacrolimus we use as at a dose of 0.1 to 0.15 mg per kilogram divided in 2 doses. And the target TRAF level is 6 to 8. 8 is maximum. We usually aim to keep them around 6. That minimizes the toxicity. Okay, so the child is taking 5 mg per kilogram of steroids, of cyclosporine for 6 months, and is in complete remission. So now how to proceed is, and you have already tapered off the steroids, right, by 0.25 mg per kilogram every 2 weeks. So that should take around 8 weeks for them to taper off the steroids. You can either stop them completely or you can continue with a very low dose of 0.25 every other day. After 6 months, you can start tapering the cyclosporine down by 0.5 mg per kilogram every 2 months to reach a minimum dose of 1 mg per kilogram. And at that dose, then you stop and continue that same treatment, stop the tapering, and continue that same very low dose of cyclosporine to complete a total duration of treatment for 2 years. And at 2 years, with a minimum of 6 months of 1 mg per kilogram dose, if they have maintained a sustained remission, you can safely stop cyclosporine. And we're still collecting our data, we haven't published this, that there is a chance that they may relapse after on low dose of cyclosporine or after stopping it. But the numbers that they quote, initially the Japanese studies had quoted almost 90% relapse rates, but then subsequent studies from elsewhere, they had quoted around 40 to 50% relapse rate. I don't think we have that high rate, but we'll see when we'll analyze our data. So, but at 2 years, if they have maintained at a very low dose, then you can safely stop it. But if they relapse again, then you can bring them back on that effective low dose of cyclosporine where they complete remission along with steroids. Again, as soon as you get the response, you decrease the dose of, you taper off the steroids, and then after 6 months, you taper off cyclosporin to that minimum dose, and again complete 2 more years. Is that clear, the audience, how we go about with cyclosporin? So, if I can tell, and again summarize this very quickly, is 5 mg/kg of cyclosporin for 6 months, then taper 0.5 mg per kg every 2 months to reach 1 mg per kg and complete 2 years. Steroids 1 mg per kg every other day. As soon as you see the response, you taper it off and stop it completely after 6 months. If no response at 3 months, you think of changing. Okay, so MMF. Anti-metabolite has been used not only as monotherapy but also in combination with CNIs, low-dose CNIs, in those steroid-resistant children who do not respond to CNIs alone. So you can add MMF to the regime along with steroids. And in multiple trials, the dosage of the results of MMF were very variable. And then finally it was concluded that actually the dose of MMF that is required in to treat these nephrotic children is much higher as compared to the one that is used post-transplant. So the recommendation is to check the levels of MMF and to achieve a trough level of up to 3 and area under curve of 45. Although these NPA levels are checking these NPA level facility is not available everywhere. But we have seen that these levels are usually achieved with, by a dose of around 1200 mg/m². And if a positive response again is seen, then you first taper off the steroids and then you taper the CNIs and then you continue this MMF and this treatment should continue for about 2 years. Cyclophosphamide also, Bagasav and his team has shown that not only in it, although we believe, I personally believe, unlike Dr. Khemchan, that for SDNS, I think cyclophosphamide is one disease-altering medication. And it has been shown in multiple trials. Not so much for FRNS, but if a child with FRNS fails levamisole, then you can give cyclophosphamide. But for steroid resistant, everyone, we believe that it does not usually, it's not the first choice. Okay, so because of its toxicity also, we are kind of reluctant to give children high doses of cyclophosphamide. However, it has been shown in trials that even in steroid-resistant nephrotic syndrome, if you give them IV cyclophosphamide, more than half of these children did respond. But they were very small trials and not very randomized or not very strong studies. However, in personal experience, my teacher, Dr. Asim Ahmed, once I referred a patient, a very difficult to treat steroid-resistant patient who was not responding to anything that I would do, went to see him, and he gave him cyclophosphamide and he went into complete remission. After seeing that patient again, my beliefs are now wavering. ASN are, they're more of an adjunctive therapies because they decrease the arteriolar pressure in the glomeruli and that's how they reduce the proteinuria. They should be reserved only for those steroid resistant children who are not responding to CNIs, who have now progressed into renal failure and you just want to do something to decrease the proteinuria so that you can prolong the life of kidney. Enalapril is preferred over captopril because it has a longer half-life. And if the creatinine does not increase too much and other complications, then you can continue. Rituximab, again, for steroid-sensitive ones is a very good choice, but not so, it does not work very well for the steroid-resistant ones. the CD20 clone population has to be eradicated from the body, and you dose it accordingly. Starting dose is 375 milligram, and you give weekly infusions till you achieve that CD20 levels. The effect of rituximab can be delayed. It's usually delayed, and it may take up to 6 months for that beneficial effect to be seen. And finally, the statins. Hypercholesterolemia always comes with nephrotic syndrome, but with steroid sensitive one, it usually goes away as soon as proteinuria resolves. But when, once it's there, the steroid resistant one, when partial response continues to have proteinuria, they have very high serum cholesterol levels. And it has been shown, especially by William Smoyer in his group, that if you treat that hypercholesterolemia in those patients, the response to cyclosporin also. So we recommend that all those who are not responding, who continue to have proteinuria, should have that cholesterol levels checked, and if it's high, then you should treat it with statins. Thank you very much. I dedicate my talk to my crew and my role model, Dr. Adhir.
Questions?
Now the topic is open for discussion.